March 15th, meeting of the Harbor Commissions will be called to order, please. Would you call the roll, please, Mary?
Betsy Kramer.
Present.
Bill Spicer.
Here.
Corey Bantolin.
Here.
Eric Friedman.
Here.
Frank Kelly.
Here.
Jim Sloan.
Here.
Helene Webb.
Present. Are there any changes to the agenda, Scott?
No, Madam Chair, there are no changes to the agenda tonight.
Okay, this would be the time we'd have public comment, but there seems to be none this evening. So we move on to the approval of the minutes.
I'll make that motion.
Second?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
They are approved. And the department update, Mr. Reedmans.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Commissioners. Since last month, the Council adopted a resolution amending the rules and regulations for issuing mooring permits in the City of Santa Barbara mooring area east of the wharf, setting minimum specifications for installing, inspecting, and repairing such moorings, and also adding an application fee, I believe, to the mooring application. Moving on to the business manager recruitment, the recruitment for the waterfront business manager position opened in late November. Due to the holidays schedule, we wanted to leave it open as long as possible because everybody tends to be distracted during the holidays. It closed on January 30th with quite a few applications received, over 90 applications received. Due to the unexpected ruling that came down on December 29th from the state level, the RDA redevelopment agencies were eliminated statewide effective February 1st. We didn't know this going into the recruitment, but this happened while the recruitment was underway. So the recruitment was canceled at that point, and Brian Bossy, who's the housing and redevelopment manager for the RDA redevelopment agency, has been selected to fill the position. Brian's here tonight, and he has a Master of Science degree in environmental studies and has worked with the city for 12 years now. All waterfront managers have worked with Brian in various projects and capacities. He's been the housing and redevelopment manager since January of 2008 and has been responsible for development, presentation, and implementation of the RDA's $20 million budget for the past 11 years. So he's got the budgetary experience required for the position. Additionally, has rental lease management experience with RDA properties, including the city's affordable housing program, the railroad depot, and most recently the old open-air bicycles building. He negotiated a lease for the relocation of the Greyhound bus station to that location, which is a pretty ideal location for that, right by the railroad depot, and a good use of that old building. Brian's still winding down his duties at RDA. It's pretty difficult shutting down a department like that. So he'll be winding that down and hopefully joining us full-time by May at the Waterfront Department. So with that, please join me in welcoming Brian Bossy to the Waterfront Management Team.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. You know more about me than I know about myself now with Scott's nice introduction. I'm very excited to join the Waterfront Department. In previous lives, John Bradley was the Housing and Redevelopment Manager for quite some time before he became the Waterfront Director. So it's I feel I've got a nice warm-up to move over to the Waterfront Department. I'm excited to work with you folks. You have a wonderful reputation, the Waterfront Department as a whole. Great projects, a very well-run organization, and that starts from you folks and the decisions you make. And then next to the managers, you have a wonderful management team as well as a great staff. So I'm very excited, and I'm honored to be a part to be a part of the Waterfront Department. And I look forward to coming over here in May.
Well, welcome, and I agree. It's a wonderful department, and it's great that you're there.
So moving on to some other vacancies and recruitments, the Waterfront Parking Supervisor, Diana Palmer, retired in December, and a promotional recruitment was recently opened to fill that vacant position. Also, Harbor Patrol Officer Wendy Cummings retired in February, and Harbor Operations Assistant Carl Halimachek was selected to fill the position following a promotional recruitment. Carl was doing double duty as the harbor operations assistant at our department, and on weekends he was a harbor patrol officer up at Morro Bay. So now he's stepped up into the Harbor Patrol. Also, an open recruitment is currently underway to fill his old position, the vacant harbor operations assistant position, and both the parking supervisor and the harbor operations assistant positions will be open through the end of this month, March 29th. On February 23rd and 24th, I attended the CMANC meetings, California Marine Affairs and Navigation Conference meeting down in Newport Beach. It's usually we meet with representatives of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, other directors, harbor and port directors, and this time I was able to meet the city's Washington, D.C. lobbyist, R.J. Lyerly, from Carpi and Clay. These meetings are held twice a year to receive the latest news on the federal budget as it pertains to dredging in harbors statewide. So you feel like a very small part of a very big project when you're up there with Port of L.A. people, Port of Long Beach, Stockton, Sacramento, or San Francisco, and so forth. And we're talking about $2 million worth of dredging, and they've got, you know, multi-million dollar projects. They had a real interesting presentation on a dredging project down in Newport Beach that was not for the purposes of navigation. It was for abatement of chemical contamination, which is a kind of unusual project and very interesting. Waterfront staff has a good working relationship with the Corps, and at this point there is $2.24 million identified in the budget for the federal fiscal year 2013, so we're happy to see that we have some money allocated there. And that'll be the third and final year of the current three-year dredging contract with AIS. And tentative items for the April meeting are the mixed annual clean marina report and the tenant selection for the 132 Harborway offices. And that concludes the report. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much for the report, Scott. Any questions, comments from the commissioners? I have a question about the dredging, but maybe that should be for Carl. Okay. So that will move on to the facilities management report. Carl?
Good evening, Madam Chair and commissioners. The spring cycle dredging is scheduled to begin tomorrow. AIS Construction Company is doing the work on behalf of the Corps of Engineers. It's the spring cycle will complete the second year of a three-year contract. As Scott mentioned, we're fortunate to have some adequate funding. Currently, they're operating under the fiscal year 2012 federal budget with a little over $2 million, and this will expend the remainder of those funds. And the President's proposed budget at $2.24 million kind of demonstrates a commitment to continued maintenance dredging in Santa Barbara Harbor. It's a good thing, and we mentioned it because the Corps of Engineers is trimming their budget just like everybody else is, and there are ports and harbors in California that did not receive funding included in the President's budget, and so we're very fortunate to be included in it, and we continue to work closely with the Corps of Engineers. We have a little change this spring. The outfall location is going to be moved up coast towards the harbor. The shoreline position has retreated dramatically on East Beach as you move up from the Cabrillo bathhouse up towards the harbor, mainly due to some serious erosion that occurred in 2008, and the beach hasn't recovered. The discharge area extends pretty much from the end of Calle Cesar Chavez, which is that street you see running north and south there, all the way down to the Cabrillo bathhouse. And we normally put the sand further down coast so that it moves with the wave energy and nourishes beaches in Montecito and Carpentry and further down coast. The beach is pretty thick, pretty fat down there and in good shape, but the beach up here is really retreated a lot. So we have the discretion to move it back and forth, and we're going to discharge it up in this location. One thing we're going to try and do a little different this year is we're going to try and take some time-lapse photography from this location to give you a sense for just how much a beach grows when you do this kind of work every year. It's kind of dramatic and kind of neat to see. So we've picked this location. The beach at high tide actually comes almost to the ice plant, which is for the first time in many, many years we've had that condition. So we're hoping we can kind of recover that beach and provide lots of recreational opportunities for the beach-going public. And finally, as a reminder, every year we want to encourage mariners to take a caution when they're navigating around the dredge. The dredge is known as a vessel that is restricted in its ability to maneuver and must show certain shapes and lights. The most important thing to know is that the safe side of the dredge has two green lights, vertical green lights, or two vertical diamonds. If you can find those, you can get around the dredge. Anything other than that, or if you're unsure, you should always call the Harbor Patrol or the dredge on Channel 16, because it can get a little confusing, especially at night. Moving over to the launch ramp, Shaw Construction Company continues to make good progress on the Boating Trails project. And this is the project that's funded with a $450,000 grant from the Department of Boating and Waterways, specifically to make improvements for non-powered vessels such as kayaks and stand-up paddle boards and small sailboats. Demolition was completed a couple weeks ago, taking out the old 1960s vintage dock. No big surprises underneath the concrete. No big surprises underneath the concrete, which was nice, and made for a fairly easy site prep. They put down this gravel, and these are actually fiberglass I-beams that some precast panels are going to be set on. There was a change order associated with this. The base material called out didn't seem suitable for the conditions, so we upped it a little bit and spent an extra $9,000 to get some material that would be suitable for the saturated conditions we find. There are 44 precast concrete panels that are made up in Reading, and they're about 7 feet wide by 16 feet long. And they'll make up, and they have a grooved surface in them, similar to the adjacent launch ramp, but slightly less, so they're a little easier on bare feet and for the type of folks that will use this launch ramp area. They're all launched with a very large crane. It's a pretty difficult exercise, as you can imagine, because all the panels that have been placed so far are underwater. So they're positioned with divers kind of using crowbars and feeling around to get them into the proper place. But fortunately, they've gotten the first several rows in, and you can see the edge to the left there. That's one of the new panels. There's a slight change in grade over the older panels, mainly because the older panels have settled a little bit, and they're not exactly straight and level. So this is a set. All these are constructed at a consistent slope, but over the years, they might settle a little bit. So there's a slight variation, but not too noticeable. And as you get into the shallower water, they're very, very even. The project is a little bit behind schedule. We've completed the demolition, the site prep, and we need to install the remaining panels at the end of this month. They're going to cast in place a concrete apron up at the top, and that'll happen the first week in April. And right after that, we're going to open up the launch ramp so people can begin to use it. Unfortunately, the new low freeboard dock that's going to be much easier for people to launch these types of craft off of isn't going to come in until about May. But the area will be open. People will be able to use it, and by May, the dock will be in, and we're hoping that everybody takes advantage of this new facility. And that concludes my report this evening. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Carl. Do we have any questions, comments, commissioners? Commissioner Kelly.
Yes, Carl, I just wanted to thank you. I like this new format of a presentation of construction material, which usually can be like eating Cheerios with no liquid. And this is very palatable, and it makes it very understandable for us as the commission, and I'm sure for anyone watching at home. So thank you, and I hope you do this in the future.
I guess not, and my question was answered in your presentation. So thank you very much. Now to the Harbor Operations Report. Mick, please.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. Well, as sort of punctuation to what has been a very, very mild winter, we actually had a boat hit the beach in late February, dragged anchor and went ashore on East Beach. It was only the second boat for the entire winter season that's hit the beach. And so it was a 43-foot sailboat, and the owner was from out of the area, and had inadvertently anchored improperly and ended up on the beach. And the reason I wanted to put this up here for you was to give you an example of where we've come to and our ability to get these boats off the beach pretty quickly. This boat went up in the evening. This was shot the evening it went up on February 26th. And then the next slide shows what the beach looked like the same time on February 27th. So, working closely with Marborg, this was paid for by the owner. I think it was about $2,400 to get it off the beach. I think over the years, through our abandoned watercraft abatement fund and working with our waste haulers, we've got it down to a pretty close to a science. And as you can see, they groom the beach back to its natural state when the boat is gone. So that's the good news. It was unfortunate for the owner. And this weekend storm notwithstanding, that may be the end of what we see of boats on the beach for this winter cycle. And winter turning to spring means that the Yacht Club was all over it on March 3rd. They had their opening ceremonies and their opening day regatta. And we also kicked off Wet Wednesdays on March 14th, just a couple of days ago. And those will go until October 17th, almost until November. And so it's a long boating season. And as a reminder, the Wet Wednesday races are open to any boat that's entered as a member of a U.S. Sailing Association recognized club. Locally, of course, that means the Santa Barbara Sailing Club and the Yacht Club. And the race courses vary. They kick off at, I think, about 5:15. And the race courses vary from 2 to 8 miles, depending on the class. And, of course, the really good part is the party at the end, the barbecue at the Yacht Club. So if you're interested in participating, you can call the Yacht Club directly at 965-8112. That's 965-8112. Or find them online at sbyc.org. It's going to be a great boating season. We sort of live two seasons in our line of work here. We have the winter season and the boating season. And we're in that transition right now and looking forward to a great boating season. On the environmental front, as you know, I've been trying to keep you updated on Senate Bill 623. That's the bill presented by Senator Christine Kehoe in San Diego that would limit and ultimately eliminate the use of copper in bottom hull paints. As you may recall, that bill stalled last year in the Assembly's Appropriations Committee, where a lot of bills stall these days on one side of the House of the aisle or the other, because that's the folks with the purse strings. And it turned into a 2-year bill. And speaking with a lobbyist for the California Association of Harbor Masters and Port Captains, he tells me that the bill will likely stay there and not see action until June. And it probably has an uphill fight, owing primarily to the fact that regulatory agencies like the Department of Pesticide Regulation and the State Water Board and of course, the regional water boards would have a role in this, and all of that costs money. And so that'll be a balance of environmental advantage and money when that is debated, rather, in June, sort of in the middle of the legislative season. The good news, and you'll hear more about it on this from me next month during the annual Clean Marina Report, is that almost every month it seems like somebody's coming out with the latest, greatest iteration of what they consider being environmentally friendly bottom paint. So that is always all going on a separate track with testing on boats and what have you. Like I say, I'll talk to you about that next month. So if this bill fails, it's not the end of the road for alternatives to copper bottom paint, or at least ablative copper bottom paint. So we'll be talking about that more soon. On the training front, I wanted to take this opportunity to talk about a very special training program that's coming to the harbor on March 26th and 27th, care of the Alaska Marine Safety Education Association, or AMSE. This safety course is free for commercial fishermen. All you have to do is tell them that you're a commercial fisherman. I called them and asked them, you know, how you prove that, and I think they're on the goodwill basis there. It's $200 for individuals, boat owners who aren't commercial fishermen. And the idea is the course is going to feature a hands-on format for donning immersion suits quickly, onboard firefighting, life raft deployment, and man overboard drills. So overboard drills. There will be a classroom segment in the waterfront community room, and there will be a field segment as well. The real nut of this course is the following. Federal law currently requires that any commercial fishing vessel operating outside of 3 nautical miles, that the master or captain of that vessel undertake safety drills at least once a month. But there is really no system to ensure that they are accredited, that they are trained, that they are certified to do what they're doing. And so pending in the Code of Federal Regulations, the CFRs, is language requiring that this is to train the trainers, that the individuals who are responsible for conducting those training sessions have, and as is described here, a drill conductor card. This is really a rollout program to sort of demonstrate to the federal government, this is a prototype for how we would like to see people trained for that kind of exercise that they'll be undertaking monthly on commercial fishing boats. And having been a commercial fisherman and having been at sea in 33 different commercial fisheries And as all of us having been witness to the news last week of that tragic episode up in Washington State, I can't tell you how important this is. So this is going to be a major step forward in training commercial fishermen in life-saving safety techniques. So if folks are interested, it's up here on the screen. But if it's not entirely legible, they can call AMSI at 888. Toll-free 888-508-3287 or find them at amsi.org online. So we're looking forward to a lot of fishermen turning up for this training in the near future here. And finally, to underscore what the waterfront director mentioned earlier, we're really proud to have Carl Halimacek join the Harbor Patrol ranks. Carl, as Scott mentioned, most folks know him for his great work at the counter as Harbor Operations Assistant. And by way of background, he has a four-year degree from Baker University in Kansas. But he also has been working very hard over the last several years to put together the resume and the skill sets it's going to take to meet what I consider as the manager of this unit to be a very high bar for Santa Barbara's Harbor Patrol. He's as Scott mentioned, served as a reserve officer in Morro Bay. He has EMT certification. He has a U.S. Coast Guard six-pack passenger carrying license. He has a towing endorsement. He's completed almost 200 hours of Department of Boating and Waterways training in boating safety and enforcement, marine firefighting, boat handling, rescue operations, and boating under the influence enforcement. So he's stepping into the job ready, and I would encourage our boating community to introduce themselves to Carl. He's a very congenial man. I think he's going to be a terrific addition to our Harbor Patrol group. And with that, I conclude my report. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Mick. Are there any questions, comments, Commissioner Friedman?
Thank you for that report, Mick. Regarding Senate Bill 623, and we said we're going to talk more about it next month. One thing I'd be interested in is, regardless of the bill status, is what outreach or programs do we have here or informational to encourage boat owners to use alternatives to copper-based paint? What programs do we have just to encourage that at our local level? And do we track, is there a way to track that, how many boaters use it or any programs? Or if not, what would it take to develop just a campaign to raise awareness on it? Thank you.
Madam Chair, Commissioner Friedman, I think currently the way we try to get the word out and encourage it is actually through this very medium that we're at right here, at the Harbor Commission, through the annual Clean Marina reports, supporting Clean Marina projects like Operation Clean Sweep and our hazardous materials turn-in day. But relative to tracking who's using alternative paints and what types of paints people are using, with your consent, I'd like to sort of get my mind around that and sleep on it and think about it, because I think maybe there probably are some ways, possibly through dock lines, possibly through, you know, a standalone survey, we could begin to see how those changes are being made. I think that's a good suggestion, and we certainly can pursue that.
Yeah, and that, talking about that next month, and if it's not, if it's something that, you know, we're just tracking it to track it, then I don't really see a point in making all that extra effort. But if there's something, if it is something that we can look at that would be useful to track it, that would be great. But if, when we're talking about it, if there's no real utility in tracking it, I don't want to make extra work for staff. So.
Commissioner Friedman, I certainly appreciate that. Thank you. I think great minds must think alike in that regard. But I, when I think about it, I when you mentioned it, the first thing that came to mind was being able to track trend lines. You know, over the next few years, are people starting to switch to, you know, non-ablative, copper-free, or, you know, alternative paints or what have you? I think it'd be interesting. We just got to figure out an affordable, both in terms of time spent and money spent, an affordable way of undertaking such an exercise.
Commissioner Sloan.
Yeah, Mick, I have two questions that aren't related. One is the boat that went aground, was that from the city mooring or was it from the free mooring? And then second question was on that copper paint regulation, are there other states or jurisdictions that already have laws against that?
Madam Chair, Commissioner, yes, there are other states that have such laws. I believe Florida, if I'm not mistaken. I know, in fact, Washington does have a law that's already been put into place, and the California law was meant to model that. So, Commissioner Sloan, I think the answer is yes. You know, there are other states, and California is trying to follow and keep pace. Relative to the boat that hit the beach, it was a visitor to our area. They weren't even from Santa Barbara, and they made an unfortunate anchoring mistake, and the boat went up on the beach. But it wasn't from the mooring area.
Great. Thank you.
Any other questions, comments? Apparently not. Mick, I was curious also about the boat. You say that Marburg got rid of it within a day. Does that mean it was salvaged, or was it destroyed?
It was disposed of. Yeah. The owner of the boat paid for it directly in a direct relationship with Marburg, and the boat was disposed of.
What a pity. Thank you for your report.
Sure. Okay.
Sorry. Commissioner Bantlon.
Hi, Mick. I'll ask another question about the boat removal. So are these large pieces, or are they small enough to where they actually have to remove some sand as part of that, and I guess, you know, dig a small hole and ensure that all the small pieces aren't still in the sand? I was just kind of curious when they break it down if it's large or small pieces.
Sure. Madam Chair, Commissioner Bantlon, it depends on the size of the boat. Typically, there's a fairly large excavator that Marburg brings down to, and it's an articulating excavator that maneuvers quite exceptionally. And so with small boats, they can take it in a couple of chomps, if you'll allow me. With larger boats, it takes a little longer time. This was being somewhat in the larger category. It also depends on how broken up they are on the beach. But no matter how they do it, you can imagine a double-jawed excavator, their sand is going to be taken up and with the debris. And what they do is they sort of, it's like decanting it, really. The sand comes out of the jaws of the excavator back onto the beach, and they rake it. And it's really just about all the sand is returned to the beach that they take up during this activity.
Any other questions, comments? And thank you very much for your report. Now on to the new business. The first item of new business is the item number 5, lease agreement with the Harbor Market. And Mary, would you read the staff recommendation, please?
Recommendation that Harbor Commission review and recommend to City Council approval of a 5-year lease with Lisa Clegg, doing business as Harbor Market, for the 676-square-foot convenience store located at 125 Harbor Way, Suite 8, at a base rent of $2,159.75 per month, subject to annual cost of living adjustments or 6% of gross sales, whichever is greater.
Thank you. And Mr. Patrick Henry.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Harbor Commissioners. The Harbor Market has been operated by Lisa Clegg since 1991. Now, most mornings you'll find her daughter manning the counter, ringing in sales, making coffee, and selling donuts. On other days, though, you'll find Lisa bustling about, stocking the shelves, smiling and carrying on banter with all the locals who pop in for their necessary sundries. And just recently, she even helped out a tourist find the ocean. I know. Lisa provides ready-to-go sandwiches, chips and soda, and even frozen bait. The term will be for 5 years, with the rent adjusted annually based on the CPI. Lisa Clegg is considered by the department to be a tenant in good standing, prompt with her rent payments, and has no lease compliance issues on file. That concludes my report, and happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. Do you have any questions, comments, or anybody? I think then we need a motion to recommend.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The motion is approved. So the next item is the, under new business, is the fiscal year 2013 operating and capital budget recommendation. And Mary, would you please read the staff recommendations?
Recommendation that Harbor Commission A, receive a staff presentation on the Waterfront Department's proposed fiscal year 2013 budget submittal. B, recommend approval of a $5 service charge on parking collection envelopes. C, recommend approval of the department's proposed changes to the fiscal year 2013 capital plan. And D, forward a recommendation to City Council for approval of the Waterfront Department's proposed fiscal year 2013 budget and incorporation into the city budget process.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, we're going to breeze through the budget part of the budget relatively quickly, since the bulk of the discussion is really the changes to the capital plan. If you want to go to the next one. We're looking at the second half of a 2-year budget with the fees having, and the budget and the fees approved in June of 2011 by the City Council. No increases in permanent staffing are proposed. However, we do have one reclassification request pending with Human Resources, and that is to upgrade an assistant parking coordinator to a coordinator position. And that's about a $14,000 increase, as I believe is articulated in your staff report. If approved, it will be somewhat offset by the new parking supervisor coming in at the first step, which is a $14,000 savings. So those will offset, and then gradually that $14,000 increase will phase in over the next 5 years or so. We've got some other savings we'll be talking about later in this report to help offset that. But we do believe it is an important reclass. The assistant coordinators have been working out a classification. We only have three people in the park, full-time permanent employees in the parking department, managing a $2.1 million program and supervising upwards of 50 or 60 hourly employees. So they're spread pretty thin, and I've been wanting to do this for several years. Another factor that we did not discuss last month was the Maritime Museum balloon payment. The Maritime Museum in 2008, the City Council directed staff to negotiate a rent buy-down lease provision with the Maritime Museum, you may recall. And at that time, the museum could pay $1 million and be relieved of all future rent payments for the remaining term of the lease, which I believe is about 30 years at this time. The agreement gave the museum 5 years to come up with that $1 million, but at the same time also credited all rents paid toward that $1 million. So they're taking the full five-year benefit. So by the time we get to when this is due, which will be April of 2013, the buy-down amount will be $270,000. So we did factor that into the revenue side of the budget, which made things look a little better. In terms of the the bulk of the discussion tonight will be changes to the capital plan. So this is will look fairly familiar from last month. This is revenue by program. It hasn't changed much. It's about $98,000 better than what we looked at last month. The big increase in the variance in the property management program is the $270,000 museum balloon payment, about $175,000 in cruise ship visits, and about $100,000 in just growth that we're seeing in our commercial leases, particularly the food service and commercial leases out on Stearns Wharf seem to be doing fairly well. So we calculated that in. And then the negative variances that you see there we'll discuss on the next slide. So the negative variances, and we did discuss this before, was the workers' comp rebate was coming in to all programs, but it was a one-time money. So we won't be seeing that next year, and that's a $453,000 value that we won't see next year. Financial management, that's just interest on our reserves, and that's been in a downward trend for several years. We did finally get the hard number from the finance department, so we plugged that into the budget. Parking revenue, we factored out about $21,000 due to the La Playa lots, the anomaly in the La Playa lots that we saw last year, and also Decor was buying quite a few parking permits from us, so we factored that out of our parking permit revenue. Decor is the crew boat operation, or they're the oil platform operators offshore, and they were coming into the harbor to do their crew transfer operations, and that was flowing in the wharfage and dockage line item of marina management, and that represents about $141,000 loss from Decor going away. Kind of a late hit. You know, we're disappointed, but I guess there are some advantages to it as well. Less pressure on the parking lots and less heavy boat traffic through the harbor, but it was good while it lasted. So moving on, expenditures. Expenditures are just about what we looked at last month. $44,000 to the good compared to what we looked at last month. We were able to trim a few things here and there. The main difference is the $421,000 transfer to the capital an additional $421,000 transfer to the capital plan, which is what we'll be talking about for the most of this meeting. But most of the rest of that is what you saw last month. So the FY 2013 capital projects will be funded, as usual, from surplus revenue and reserves above policy that we have. Also, any additional funding needed will come from our capital reserve or the Harbor Preservation Fund. And then we do have significant state grant and loan funding coming from Department of Boating and Waterways this year, as in past years. So Carl's going to talk a little bit about the changes in the capital plan, what's changed over what was already approved last year. So we'll focus on the changes next.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, as a reminder, by the city charter, the capital improvement program is to be reviewed by the City Council 90 days before adoption of the budget. You last looked at our capital improvement plan in September 2010. If the council adopts a one-year budget, they by default approve 1 year of the capital improvement program, although we have a six-year capital improvement program. With the adoption of the two-year budget, they by default approve the first 2 years of our capital improvement program. So since we've moved into the second year, things have changed a bit, and we've got there's a few projects we'd like to implement, a few projects we wouldn't like to carry forward with, and I'll talk a little bit about a project that we discussed at the budget subcommittee meeting. The first change is an addition, and that is the remodeling of the restrooms in the 119 building. And these are highly used restrooms just below Brophy Brothers. Thousands of people use them every year, and they're out of compliance with the Americans with Disabilities Act and just in a bit of disrepair. Last year, we remodeled the Marina 3 restroom, and this is the layout in the tile pattern. And we'll take this same pattern and the same kind of aesthetic and apply it to the 119 building, Brophy Brothers restroom, and at the same time, reconfigure the interior to make it ADA compliant. We estimate this cost at about $90,000. And at the end of going through each project, I'll talk a little bit about how we're funding these. Some of them are partially funded, and some of them are going to acquire some new funds. The next project is the accommodation dock. The accommodation dock has two fingers, two legs to it. The one most people are familiar with is the southerly one. We rebuilt it last year in fiscal year 2011. I believe we spent $90,000 on it. We extended it 15 feet. We widened it by 8 feet. We widened it to 8 feet from 6 feet. And it's been a very popular improvement. Everybody who pulls in there, whether they're visitors or part of the Wet Wednesday crowd, they really, really appreciate it. The north leg is where we keep patrol boats 2, 3, and 4, and we also have a Harbor Patrol shed there for some rescue equipment, some maintenance equipment. Last year in a late season storm, it started to separate and pull apart in a rough southeasterly, and so it's in bad shape. It was built in the 1980s, and it really needs to be replaced. Based on our experience replacing the south leg of the accommodation dock in Marina 3B NTIE, our staff is comfortable designing this. It's an in-house design, and we believe we can reconstruct that section for about $75,000, and this would happen next year. Then the whole facility would be about the same vintage. The next project is the Luke self-pay station project. As has been reported to the Commission several times, we've installed three of these units in the Harbor West lot, and it's really, really been a great improvement. Our revenues are way up. Compliance appears to be way up on the order of 30%. And so based on the success, we went ahead and we bought additional units for the remaining lots and had planned on putting in three units this year in the Chase Palm Park parking lot and two units in the Garden Street parking lot. There's a fairly well-known cost for just putting the units in, repouring the concrete, and what we paid at the Harbor West. But what you see in these pictures, these blue lines represent all the trenching necessary to bring in power and communications to each of these. It's about 300 feet in the Chase Palm Park lot, over 200 feet in the Garden Street lot, and it's really quite expensive. So we put this out, we designed this in-house again and put it out to bid and received a low bid of $125,000. It was a little higher than we wanted to connect these and communicate with them, so we looked at going solar with wireless communications. The hard wiring is much more reliable. We've talked to many other communities that have these, and they do use solar and wireless, but We got some feedback that wasn't very reassuring about the reliability of it. It's significantly less on the order of $65,000 to upgrade the units themselves and to do some of the installation. You still got to do concrete work. But the unknown is the operating costs. We looked at a couple different packages with Verizon and one package with the vendor DPT. And we really couldn't figure out what it would cost to operate these things. You know, some plans are by the amount of data you send, some by the amount of transactions. They assume a certain amount of transactions, and we couldn't really balance that out within a lot. So it's really difficult to predict. And so we're pursuing advancing this project with a more reliable hardwire installation through the bid that we already have. And we've already negotiated a little bit of a discount on that on the order of $17,000. We're trying to bring that down a little bit, but that's what we're pursuing at this time. And I believe Scott has a little more to add on this item.
Yes, thanks, Carl. As the Budget Committee will recall, we discussed this new change at that meeting. I believe it was Commissioner Sloan requested that we look into some other areas because we're seeing a 35% jump in revenue in the Harbor West lots, and overall parking's up 10%. So if you factor that out, it's probably fair to say we have a 25% revenue jump by installing these machines in Harbor West. But as Commissioner Sloan pointed out, that's only one model to base this on going forward. So I put in calls to two distributors, Digital Payment Technologies and Central Parking, and they confirmed that it is not at all unusual to see a 25 to 30 to even 35% jump in revenue. And then this afternoon I spoke with Frank Ching, the Santa Monica Parking Administrator. He's also a customer of these units down in Santa Monica, and he further confirmed that you can easily see 25 to 35% revenue gain. He switched from an automated machine, a Ventec type machine, which just takes cash, but not, you know, more advanced than our honor fee slotted boxes, but still didn't take credit cards. So he went from a similar pay on foot device to these credit card devices and immediately saw 30% increase in his revenue, which he attributes to an increase in the number of transactions since people can use their credit card and comply, and an increase in the revenue also because people tend to want to buy more time. If they're not sure how long they're going to be there, it's painless to put your credit card in there and, you know, put an extra $2 on there. So so the good news here is we can expect significantly, I believe we can expect, in addition to labor savings, that we can expect some good additional revenue when we convert these two much larger lots to this system. So I did some more analysis which we can talk about. But with this additional expense Carl's talking about, these units would pay for themselves within 6 years with just the labor savings. But if you factor in just a 10% increase in revenue, they would pay for themselves in about 2.5 years. So we're still at a real reasonable return on investment. And again, that's being conservative and saying we might see 10% extra revenue when I'm hearing it could be more than that. So we're real excited to get these going and see if that's true or not. Could really help our budget out quite a bit. So I just wanted to add that because it was a request of the Budget Committee. Thanks, Carl.
The next project is a project we'd like to withdraw from the capital improvement program, and that involves restoring the historic acorn lights on the breakwater. This is a project that several of the tenants have expressed interest in. They had these acorn lights out there many, many years ago. They all got washed off in storms. When the breakwater cap was replaced in the 1970s, they put some lights in the walls, but those immediately stopped functioning for a variety of reasons. They first advanced this in around 2002 or 2003, and they couldn't move forward with it. There were lots of problems. But we tried again when John Bradley was director. He was interested in this, and we put this in an outlying year to try it again, and it showed up. So this year we had, I think, $30,000 for design work. And as I started looking into that, I went back through the file and found an old legal opinion that essentially stated that anything you do out there, you need to meet current lighting standards. And that the previous analysis, the design work, they could not meet the lighting standards with replacing the historic acorn lights. This is considered a walkway, like a sidewalk, and that the city attorney and others have determined that you need to have the same foot candle power, the same lumens that you'd have on a sidewalk, and you just can't do it with the historic lighting. You'd have to have a whole different lighting program. So we thought that this was a little too much to take on. They failed attempting this several years ago, and we felt that this wasn't a project worth pursuing at this time, resurrecting and going through that and probably not coming up with the desired project, which was recreating the historic element out there. In exchange for that, we're proposing that we complete the replacement of the breakwater cap. It's a little bit hard to see here, but in 2004, we completed phase one, 2007 phase two, and 2009 in phase three. So all of this is new. This radius area also experiences a lot of wave impacts and is starting to fall apart a little bit. So for about the same price, about $400,000 compared to $360,000, we think we can finish this project out. And this is the primary protection for the harbor. And I've been a little uncomfortable deferring it. We've had it identified in the CIP as an unfunded project, a want to do, but just really had a hard time applying the funds to it. So that's the next project we're proposing as part of the CIP adjustments. The final change is a dock widening project at the end of Marina 4B. The large vessels you see here, we put in 16 new piles in 2007. We used to have a whale watching vessel there and a research vessel there, and there were some old wooden piles that were rotting away. So we had a very successful project in 2007 whereby we accommodate three large vessels. One is the Shearwater, a research vessel. Another is a private vessel. And the third one is one of Captain Fred's charter vessels. It's a great program, but part of the problem is the end tie is only 4 feet wide and does not meet the Boating and Waterways guidelines for a dock that long, especially when you have very large vessels right next to very small vessels. When we put the steel piles in, the 16 steel piles, we purposely offset them from the dock in anticipation of widening this one. Based on our experience last year designing the Marina 3B end tie widening project, it's another in-house design. We've already have it designed, and we'd like to go ahead and build this next year for an estimated cost of $75,000. And finally, this is a project we're not proposing that we add in the FY13 capital improvement program. But this is a project we discussed with the subcommittee last month, and this is replacement of the ice house. The ice house has had repeated breakdowns, and we decided to undertake an assessment this year. In the preliminary assessment, the fellow that's been doing it, the city's facilities and energies manager, has suggested that we replace it, that it's just not worth investing in anymore. So, but the price is pretty high. It's about $400,000 to replace just the ice making unit. This is not part of the delivery unit or anything else. So it's a big expensive endeavor. So we've decided we'd like to pursue completing the assessment and put together plans and specifications in this fiscal year, and possibly replace it in fiscal year 2014. So this would show up as part of the regular capital improvement plan review and approval, and as part of the regular budget. It wouldn't be kind of a mid-budget cycle adjustment like the other projects that we're suggesting. So this, just for your information, just wanted to let the rest of the commission know. We already let the subcommittee members know. So moving on, I believe here's a summary of these adjustments. Some of the projects are partially funded. Some of them are brand new. Overall, it's about a $360,000 variance, and that would be adding $360,000 to the capital improvement plan for fiscal year 2013. We do have the funds in the Harbor Preservation Fund. It pencils out when we look at our cash flow model, so we're comfortable moving forward with these adjustments. And Scott will be moving on with the remainder of the presentation.
Thank you, Carl. The fee increases that were approved by the council last year were the 2%, slip transfer fee of $25 per foot, going from $300 a foot to $325 a foot, except for the 20-foot slips, which were frozen at $200 per foot several years ago. I guess that would be 4 years ago. The slip fee that was approved last year as part of the council action was a 2% slip fee, coming off of 3 years of higher slip fees. So this is getting back down to kind of where we'd like to keep it. The new proposal is for a service charge on collection envelopes, the courtesy collection envelopes that we issue to folks in a couple of different situations that I described in your staff report. One is the situation where the person pulls out of the parking kiosk, say Stearns Wharf, and they've forgotten their purse or they don't have any cash on them or their checkbook, because we'll take checks too. And so we will write them a courtesy collection envelope for the face value of the amount that they owe. Since we've implemented the parking credit cards in the staffed kiosks, we've seen that type of situation virtually disappear. Almost everybody has either cash or a check or a credit card, and we could still write them a courtesy collection envelope without a service charge for a situation like that where they may have forgotten their purse or something. What we see a lot more of is in the honor fee lots, where people pull in and they don't put the money in the machine. So our monitors go out and they write them a service charge for the full day's cost of parking, which in the honor fee lots is only $7. There's no service charge, so it's the face value. And we're pretty reasonable. If the people call in and they can prove that they weren't there for the full day, that they were only there for an hour or two, we'll knock it down to the $3. But again, we're talking face value for this thing. So we'd really like to add a $5 service charge minimum on these collection envelopes to offset the cost of staffing and tracking them and collecting them and so forth. And the budget committee did talk about perhaps a $10 charge. We just modeled this after what downtown parking charges is $5, but the budget committee was discussing $10. So that would be the change. The six-year cash flow assumptions, there's a six-year cash flow spreadsheet draft in your packet. It assumes a revenue growth in property management and parking of 2% per year. It assumes a continuation of the slip transfer fee increase of $25 per foot per year and a slip fee increase of 2% per year. The capital program is $3.7 million, less the Department of Boating Water and Waterways grant and loan of $2.2 million. So our total capital plan would be up to $1,450,000, or as Carl said, a $360,000 increase over what's already been approved. So that's what we're asking for tonight. And again, we put out a projected debt coverage ratio. This drops down in fiscal year 17 and 18 in the out years to below the required 1.5 debt coverage ratio. We discussed this at some length last month. We drop down to 1.41 in FY17 and 18. Again, that's in the out years, and it can be addressed through a variety of means. Hopefully this parking program works out the way we want it to. Otherwise, going back to a 3% slip fee increase in the years 2015 through 2018 would also straighten out that trend and get you back above that line. And again, this is the slide we like to show, showing the green line, the upper line is the operating revenue, and the blue line is the operating expense. And so we've got a little margin there. We're planning on more revenue than expense. Last month, we discussed reserve requirements. There's some additional information in your packets as well that was requested. Delineating where those are articulated in the fee resolution or in the council resolution and in Title 17 of the municipal code. But again, we have three basic reserves: the economic contingency reserve for future year's budget and the harbor preservation fund or the capital reserve. And again, the reserve balances stay above the required harbor preservation fund mandate of $2 million in the six-year model that we have in your packet tonight. So moving on to the next one, just in terms of summary for the operating budget, we're projecting revenues of $12,094,000, operating expenditures of $11,354,000, and capital projects net after the Department of Boating and Waterways grant and loan of $1,450,000. We do currently have $1,350,000 in reserves above policy in the operating fund, which comes very close to covering that capital project. So we would not have to dip very much, if any, into the other reserves, into the Harbor Preservation Fund. We could probably make that money up in excess revenue next fiscal year. So we're in good shape to implement these projects. Just to touch on our performance measurement program objective, we usually just like to give a couple examples. The department actually has 37 measurable objectives that we track in all nine programs, and 60 what we call tracking measures. You know, but this is just a couple of examples. One that we added this year in the parking program was to reduce salary expense by $15,000 through the installation of the new self-pay parking system in the Garden Street lot. And we would expect a similar savings in the Palm Park lot, but we're taking it conservatively at this point and seeing how it actually comes out. Another one, for example, in Harbor Patrol has quite a few. One of them is respond to 96% of in-harbor emergencies within 5 minutes. And in facilities for this year, an objective is to rebuild 16 20-foot slip fingers in Marina 2 with staff effort. So just to recap, the approved fee increases at this point from the council approval last year is a 2% slip fee increase and a $25 per foot slip transfer fee increase, except the 20-foot slips. The new fee recommendation from staff is a $5 service charge on the collection envelopes. We're also waiting on the parking reclassification of assistant parking coordinator to coordinator. And then we're asking for and recommending additional changes to the capital budget in the amount of $360,000. And this was just the schedule of review that we've been through. Today we're at the March meeting with the recommendation. We're scheduled to go before the council in a work session format to deliver this to the council at 9 a.m. on May 2nd. And then the council ultimately adopts the budget usually in mid to late June. And that concludes the report. Carl and I would be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much, Scott, and also Carl. And any comments, questions from the commission? Commissioner Sullivan.
Yeah, just two questions. So the $5 parking fee, do we have any idea about how much revenue that would project? I know that it's based on the new parking systems, and we haven't put all those in, but do you have any ideas?
Yes, Madam Chair, Commissioner Sloan. We, in the past, have issued up to 5,000 collection envelopes in a year. We expect that number to drop, both because of the new credit cards in the kiosks and also if we put in this penalty as well. We did not budget for that because it's scattered out among all the parking lots, so it would be a little tiny chunk in each parking lot, so we didn't budget for that.
Okay. And then the other one is one of those measures that you showed was the Harbor Patrol 96% response within 5 minutes. How are we doing on that?
Madam Chair, Commissioner Sloan, actually we raised that to 96% from 95% because we were outperforming ourselves. So we've been running at 98-100%, so we're gradually bumping up the bar.
Great. Thank you.
Commissioner Friedman.
I had a question regarding the $5 fee again. It said in the report that the committee discussed $5 or $10, and if we were to go with like a $10, would there be any difference, because the rest of the city, if I have it correct, is $5. So would it create any extra accounting to go between the two, or would it have any effect at all?
No, Commissioner Friedman, it wouldn't have any effect at all. We're independent of the downtown parking and airport parking programs.
Bantlin.
I'd have no problem going to 10. My question on that is, how long after we issue that, I guess, is the penalty, or when would it go up? You know, if we're going to charge them $10, I'm fine with that. But when are they going to get dinged again? How long do they have to pay before they're going to get dinged again?
Commissioner Bantlin, currently what happens is we issue the collection envelope and they have 10 working days to get the payment to the office, to the parking office. If we do not receive it within about 10 or 15 working days, we package them up and send them up to the police department where they tack on a pretty substantial service charge. I believe it's at least $20. And then they attempt to collect it. If when they collect it, they send our amount back to us and then they keep their fee. So we track that through a journal entry type. If they do not pay the police department within a certain amount of time, and I don't know what that time frame is, it goes to the Department of Motor Vehicles, and you get that tacked onto your vehicle registration.
Thank you. So is it feasible then for us to extend that period a little bit before we send that to the police department? If we charge them $10 but extend that to 21 working days, is that possible?
Commissioner Bantolin, in practice, we've been doing that. We've been trying to keep them in the department for as long as we can, up to a month even, to give them every opportunity to pay so we don't have to package them up and send them out to PD. The trouble is, you may have read about some of the issues going on over at the police department with these very items, these type of items, tickets and collection envelopes. And so they're really short-staffed over there right now and have begged us to not sit on these things for 30 days and then give them a whole huge heap of them. They want them at least every 2 weeks.
Now, I assume, though, that they're going down because, you know, we're issuing a lot less of these. So what we may have given them in 2 weeks prior could be the same amount in 1 month now that we're issuing fewer of these. Is that plausible? Or?
It's possible. We don't have that much data. We only just started the credit cards in the kiosk on December 1st, so we just have a couple months of data there. But by far the bulk of them are issued in the honor fee lots. So we'd have to look at that data. It's possible, and when they get back up fully staffed.
So is it within our purview to change that time frame, I guess, in statute from the 10 working days? Or is that a staff call?
I'd have to look into that. I believe we just have to do that interdepartmentally by communicating between Waterfront and the police department and see what they, you know, at the staff level and see what they can or can't deal with.
Okay. And I know I'm diving into a pretty small issue here, but I was going to want to recommend that we do bump it up to 10, you know, but that we do give folks, say, 30 calendar days before we bump it up to the police department. Or would you be comfortable with 21 instead?
I would have to discuss it with the police department folks and get back to you in terms of what would be acceptable to them.
Okay.
Commissioner Friedman?
So in terms of tonight, I'll support that. In terms of tonight, though, can we vote on that tonight, or would we have to bring back the fee? Because is it, if we're putting them together then and you don't have an answer on the number of days, could that come back, or could we vote on the fee today and then come back on the
later? I'd be willing to amend the motion just to say that, you know, staff can look into that and, if possible, implement it at 21 calendar days.
I'll support that for the $10 and 21.
Commissioner Sloan.
Not to muddy the water, but since we're on that subject. So the way I understand that, there are two different ways that people can forget to pay for it. One is in the Harbor Main lot, they go through, they get a ticket, they come out, they don't have their wallet or something like that. It's an oversight on their part. The other is in the lots with the automated collection system, someone just pulls in and says, well, nobody's looking, I'm not going to pay. And so does it make sense to have two different tiers of that or something like that, where in the Harbor Main lot, maybe $5 makes sense because people probably intended to do it. They're not intentionally skipping out on it because they have a ticket and they pick the ticket and everything else. But in the honor lots, you know, I think we're going to see more and more of that. You know, there's a machine, nobody's looking, and you know, maybe it makes sense to make that penalty a little stiffer as well.
Commissioner Sloan, just to further muddy the waters, there is a third scenario, and that is when we close a lot and there are cars left in the lot. And we will also go out there and then issue the collection envelope. And then the instructions on the envelope are put your ticket in the envelope and send in the, you know, it instructs them how to calculate what their fee is going to be. Send in the balance with your ticket and we'll take care of it with your parking ticket. So in those two scenarios, the ones where they inadvertently forgot their wallet or we closed the lot and the vehicle was still in the wallet, we would want to design, or the vehicle is still in the lot, we would want to design these new collection envelopes so they have a choice, so the monitor or the kiosk operator can check the box for the $10 service charge or not, given the different situations that we're dealing with here. It is a courtesy collection envelope in the case of the person that forgot their money.
Right. Commissioner Bantolin.
So then they would just be charged the $7 maximum without the $10 fee if that wasn't checked. Is that correct? Did I get that right?
Yeah, whatever the value of the
or less whatever
the whatever parking that they actually used. For instance, in the case of when we closed the lot, the car was still there. We go and put the collection envelope on the windshield, and if it turns out they just drove in there 15 minutes before, you know, it might not be anything.
That's right. Okay, thank you.
Other commissioner comments? Then I have a, Commissioner Batalon.
To amend the motion?
Yeah, I don't know where that leaves us. That's it.
I don't.
We talked a lot. Yeah, I can make a recommendation.
All right, well, I'll amend the motion then to include, I guess, staff discretion to waive the $10 in those two circumstances. Is that what you were looking for?
Well, I don't know what the right thing to do is for the guy that forgot his wallet. You know, I think there are two different. The point I was trying to make is one's intentional or could be intentional, and the other is an oversight. Or if we give them the benefit of the doubt, it's an oversight. You know, where if someone just pulls into the lot, you know, they could have forget to do it. That's obvious. People, that happens to everybody. But a lot of people are going to start looking around, and if nobody's around, they're not going to pay. You know, and if all they get is the same amount, all of a sudden the incentive is, well, if I don't pay, I'm going to end up paying the same amount anyway. I mean, there has to be some incentive for them to use the payment system besides just being those people. So I was thinking of having two different tiers of it. You know, if we're going to make it $5, we make it $5 for the one people that inadvertently forgot their wallet, the Harbor Main lot, and then any of the lots that we still physically close and put the envelopes on, and then for the honor system where you can pay with a credit card and we made it easy for everybody to pay, then it's a little higher fee. That was my only comment.
So I think there's a motion. I'm not too exactly sure what it is. Do you want to restate it for Mary? Or Mary, maybe you know what it is, Mary?
Is that going to be too complicated for staff to implement, or is that okay?
I'm looking for a comment.
I
believe we can accommodate that situation. I mean, we were thinking of keeping it just as no fine for the person who inadvertently forgot his wallet and the $10 service charge for the person who's cheating, or the 5 and 10 works. It's not too cumbersome for us to do.
I'm good with your.
Do you want to do staff discretion or zero?
Yeah, I'm good with what you suggested, Scott, the 0 and 10.
But there is a motion that's been seconded, so I think that what do you want to do?
Can I try and clarify?
You want to drop it?
I think it's basically the staff recommendation, but to up to $10 rather than $5.
Is that you?
That's what it is.
To try and increase it if possible.
Yeah, and then to try to increase the length to 21 days. Sure.
Okay, is that clear? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? I guess it passes.
We had a couple of abstentions, I think.
Were there?
Yes.
Oh.
Did you buy? No. I didn't either. I abstained.
There were two abstentions, and 5 in favor, two abstentions. Okay. Any other? Excuse me? Yeah, right. Any other commissioner comments? Because I have something I'd like to bring up. And I received an email today from Bennett Garr of Bennett Garr Sales and Marine Canvas. And it says, to whom it may concern, I've been a sailmaker and boat owner in Santa Barbara Harbor for over 35 years. More than most, the middle class has been affected by the current economic recession. The sales for 20 to 25-foot boats have been stagnant for some time. Rather than raise the transfer fees across the board, a more logical approach would be to devise a sliding scale for fees based on the length of the slip. It seems excessively burdensome that a buyer of a 20-foot boat would have to pay the same fees that a buyer of a 60-foot yacht is willing to pay. I hope you will consider this option when making a decision on this new policy. Sincerely, Bennett Garr. Since the fees have already been decided by the City Council and also approved by us for this year, I think there's probably nothing that can be done for this fiscal year. But I think this is something that should be discussed in the coming year. And I'm not sure how that to go about it. And there's another issue as well that's come up as to whether the transfer fees on the 25-foot boats should be frozen as they are on the 20-foot boats. I believe this is something that was done about 4 or 5 years ago for the 20-foot boats, and the idea was, if I'm correct, that they would be looked at for the 25-foot boats. And for this coming year, how should we approach that, Scott? Should we have an ad hoc committee? Should we just be part of the budget committee? Or what does the commissioners think about this whole issue?
I'd suggest just putting it through the budget committee. And we don't have to wait until January or February.
Right.
There's no reason we couldn't get together any time and hash some of these things out.
Okay. And does anyone on the commission want to make any have any comments?
I just have a couple of comments on
Commissioner
that.
Commissioner Sloan.
To understand it, so he's making a recommendation that we have a lower fee for up to what size?
He's talking about reexamining the whole way the transfer fees are done, and the more to devise a sliding scale for fees based on the length of the slip. He doesn't cut it off at any point.
Okay.
So the other point was that the 25-foot transfer fee should be frozen, as the 20-foot ones are, rather than the 25-foot.
Do we have any 25-foot slips? What's a breakdown of the slips, just in rough terms? We have so many 20-foot slips, so many 30-foot slips, something like that.
Got me on that one, Commissioner Sloan.
But
by far the bulk of the harbor, 75% of the harbor slips are 35 feet and under, as I recall.
Okay.
24-25% of the slips in the harbor are 25 feet and under. I think what Mr. Garr is talking about, we're heading down that path already. We did freeze the 20-foot slips, and they're not paying the same transfer fee per foot as anybody else. And assumably, as the transfer fee gets higher and higher, we would continue to do that, as Chair Kramer suggested, get with the budget committee and discuss the 25s as part of the upcoming budget process. And then as this goes along, you look at them as you move along year to year. And I think that's where we're at. That's what we're doing.
Right. Right. And I'm not sure I agree with him. You know, if you're paying $325 times 20 feet is a lot different than times 60 feet. In fact, it's three times more. But I understand his point. The net dollars for a 60-foot transfer fee is a lot higher than a 20-foot transfer fee. But when we do, slip fees are a sliding scale based on size, aren't they? And what's the breakdown? 25 and under, 30? 25 to 35, or do you know offhand, Scott? Do you have
Madam Chair, Commissioner Sloan, I have the piece of paper, the magic piece of paper that has this breakdown. To answer your first question, we have 243 25-foot slips out of a total inventory of 1,137 slips. The one thing I didn't bring was my calculator, but it looks like about 20% to me. And, not to edge over into the budget side of things from the operations side, but but you know, it depends on how you define sliding scale. In my mind, the way we implement our slip fee increases and the way we implement our transfer fee is a sliding scale. It's a sliding scale based on the size of the slip you have.
Right.
It costs more to transfer a boat in a 50-foot slip than it does to transfer a boat in a 30-foot slip. I think, and I've known Bennett Garr for years and have the highest respect for him, I think what Mr. Garr is suggesting is that that's even somehow more exaggerated, that the slip transfer fee be higher on the bigger slips and lower on the lower slips. But that's for the budget committee to hammer out.
But the slip fees, the monthly slip fees per foot, is that a sliding scale based on size?
Yes, Commissioner Sloan, the 20-footers pay X amount per foot, and the 28s have a different, the 25s have a different category, so do the 28s, and it goes up to the 50s and 60s, and then the end ties.
Okay.
So the difference is that the increases, like a 2% increase, applies to everybody.
No, I understand.
But the scale is sliding, right. Absolutely.
Right. Right. So that might be a basis for looking at the transfer fees or something, I mean, to his point. You know.
Carl reminds me, it's about, we did this year before last, I believe, when we looked at the different levels between the different slips, and it appeared to us at the time that the 10-foot increments, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, 40 to 50, and so on, were about 8.5% more. And so you might remember we came to you 2 years ago because the 60-foot slips were the same as the 50-foot slips. So we put that 8.5% on there, and then on 70 and 80 and 90 for the, some of the end ties.
Right, right. And that's what I remember. So it's in 10-foot increments is kind of what it is.
Not all of our slips are. We have 43s and we have 28s and 51s and all kinds of off-the-wall stuff, but we looked at the 10-foot increments.
Well, so what we might do, what I might recommend is that we do put that to the Budget Committee, and the next time the Budget Committee gets together, we will consider that and see if we can't come up with a plan, whether it's this year or part of next year's budget or something like that.
Right. I think we should have a special meeting of the Budget Committee, as you say, rather than waiting until January. But that's a standing committee, and so that's open to the public for anybody. I mean, it'll be noticed around the harbor, so hopefully maybe Mr. Garr will come to the meeting or anybody else who has ideas to express the thoughts. Okay. Any other comments from commissioners? Okay.
Madam Chair, we do need a motion on
I was just moving
C and D.
That.
Okay.
Right, okay. Yes, we, as Scott just said, we do need a motion, and it will be on the we've done the recommend approval of a $5 service charge, and what we need a motion to recommend approval of the department's proposed changes to the fiscal year 2013 capital plan, and also to forward that recommendation to the City Council for approval of the Waterfront Department's proposed fiscal year 2013 budget and incorporation of the city budget process. Anybody want to make that motion?
Chairman Kramer, do we need to bifurcate this in the voting process so that those of us that actually are slip holders don't vote on, we usually do this, don't vote on the things where we have the conflict of interest?
I think I asked about that earlier.
Yeah, Madam Chair, Commissioner Kelly, I don't believe we do, because the slip fee increase and the slip transfer fee increase were approved by the council last years. They've already been approved, so really what we're talking about is just the little changes to the operating budget, the capital budget, and,
just wanted to check.
Sure, thank you.
So do you want to make a motion to that effect, Commissioner Kelly?
Sure, I will move that we approve the recommendations as presented with the little filigree on point B. It was the big discussion.
I'll second that. And so really what we're doing is we're recommending moving to approve C and D.
Exactly. Is there any,
is that correct, Frank? Is that
That's correct, yes.
Any discussion of the motion? Then all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Abstentions? It's unanimous. So the now we're on to the last section, the staff commission communications.
Madam Chair, staff has nothing for tonight.
Nothing to communicate?
We haven't already beat to death.
Okay. Do we have anything to communicate to staff?
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
We're adjourned.